Welcome to another episode of ERG Power Talk. I'm your host, Joe Santana. That song clip is from We Gotta Get Out of This Place. It was written by a husband and wife team named Barry Mann and Cynthia Well, and it was performed by the British rock group The Animals. The lyrics express the collective feelings and reflection on the part of many people post-pandemic and social unrest. The result of this collective moment of just taking stock and reflection is that 4.4 million people in the United States quit their jobs in September 2021. That's a staggering record-setting number. And while the management in many organizations is announcing back-to-work site plans, 52% of the workers are saying they would rather quit their jobs than go back to pre-pandemic work levels in company buildings. Polls in other countries reflect very similar results. And I would say that collectively, what organizations are experiencing is feedback from the modern workforce. And that feedback is saying, we don't want things the way they used to be. So what is it that repels members of the modern workforce who've had an opportunity to get away from their workplaces during the pandemic and do a little bit of reflection? What do they want? And what must leaders do? And what can ERGs do to help their companies address this challenge? That's our topic for today, how ERGs can help corporations survive that great resignation and retain their good people. And to help us explore this topic, we have two special guests. One is a leadership and culture strategist. She is also an author, a speaker, a thought leader, and the CEO, co-founder of a 21st century leadership training and market research company. The other guest is her company co-founder and partner. He is an expert at helping brand leaders understand how to create environments of belonging that allow people everywhere to have everyone who participates thrive. So, Lisen and Corey, please introduce yourself.
Hi, everyone. Joe, thank you for having us. And for all who are here, thank you for joining. And those on live stream, good to not see you, but wave at you at least. We're just thrilled to be here. Thanks.
Hi. Yes, thank you, Joe, for the opportunity to talk about such an important topic. I'm happy to be here with you, with your audience, and everyone who enjoys it. And certainly happy to be here with my partner, wonderful partner, Lisen.
Well, thank you both so much, Corey and Lisen, and welcome to the show. It's really a pleasure having both of you here. And I see a lot of interest in this particular topic that we're going to be talking about today. So I can't wait to jump into it. But first, tell me a little bit about your individual journeys that got both of you to where you are today. And Lisen, if we can start with you, that would be great.
Sure. So I actually had my own great resignation in the late 1990s. I had an MBA. I was kind of on the fast track in my career. Everything was going really well. And then I was on bed rest for 4 months, which was my COVID moment, my liminal time with my second child. And that moment, those 4 months, gave me a really amazing chance to sit back and say, what is this? Where do I want to be? What does this look like? When I went back, I realized the workplace was just too toxic. The environment wasn't going to let me thrive or succeed. There was a lot of motherhood bias, a lot of just gender bias. And I said, this isn't working. So I paused my career and ended up coming back to the workplace, really passionate about figuring out how can we create inclusive environments for women, for diverse people? What does this look like? What does it mean not to be the ideal worker that is typically white, male, has a spouse at home 24/7, et cetera? So that was my journey. I ended up writing the book, Work, Pause, Thrive, about how people navigate these choices in their careers. And along that journey, I'll just briefly say, I was working in advertising and the Fearless Girl came out. Remember that little statue that was challenging the bull? And it was this moment of this incredible, like, pay equity, let's go do it. But if you actually looked at State Street, which was the company that was advancing the campaign, their internal truth was completely misaligned with their advertising statement. And I said, that was the final straw. And I said, I've got to do something different. Met Corey, he can tell you how we met. And we've been passionate about innovating cultures, innovating leaders ever since.
That's great, Lisen. I think you hit upon one of the insights in terms of why this is happening. When you talked about the fact that you took that pause, and I think that's part of it is the pause. There may be other elements, but when you take a pause, sometimes you have an opportunity to reflect on what you're doing, where you're doing it, how you're really feeling about it. And that leads to new choices and decisions, right?
Right.
I think that that's one of the insights. In fact, I think I read somewhere that most people make decisions about what they're going to do next when they're either on vacations or just when they step away and they pause. Mm-hmm. So I think that's one of the insights that you already shared there in your own experience. Corey, what about you?
My journey has been quite the journey. My background is really in content creation, being a creative, and I started with a couple of nonprofits, helping them to tell their story to massive audiences with purpose. And in that, I realized just early on in my career that leadership was so important. That how you represent, how you stand up as a leader, how you show up for your people. Especially when you're not able to compensate them probably what their value because it's a nonprofit, it is so important to be able to have a true tie to purpose and one that your people can be aligned to. And I held on to that throughout my career, moving on through advertising, helping to start an agency, and ultimately becoming an executive creative director at a major agency, which is where I met Lisen. And along the way, realizing how people like me were being treated, when I saw that I was in a position of leadership, I knew that I didn't want people to experience that, have that same experience, the things that I saw or witnessed or the experiences that I had. So I bucked the system a bit and how I engaged with the people on my team, with how I lifted up, with how I amplified and promoted them. And it was disruptive, but it was very, it was received very well by my team. And in the midst of me being the first person of color who's an executive creative director, you realize in a lot of spaces, you're the only person in those spaces. So it becomes, you know, how do you fight against that? How do you hold that banner up for, you know, to do the right thing and not not swallow your voice? And I've gotten some encouragement from the chief diversity officer at the agency, like, hey, you know, you should be doing more diversity work. And I was like, I'm a creative. I'm in advertising. This is my thing. But honestly, really realizing the results really touched my heart. And I took a training on being a man ambassador. And Lisen walks into the room in her group, and we talked about what it takes to be a better leader, how to be a better ally. And there were a lot of moments where we were like, we're on the same page. I see you, you see me, and just chalk that up. And when I left my last role, I took some time, my own liminal time to, and this was pre-pandemic, of what did I really want to do? Where did I really want to go? And reached out to Lisen, and it was just the perfect timing. We were able to talk about what it means to transform cultures at companies and how to really change the landscape for business leaders and for people in business. And it's great for me because I was able to tie my earlier work of bringing purpose and leadership to branding and messaging and helping brands be able to align in that and make a better way for their people. And so that's why we founded Prism Work, and it's been wonderful ever since.
And that's great. It sounds like a perfect partnership to me.
It is.
In fact, really that is. Was the impression I got when I looked at your LinkedIn profiles, and I saw that both of you have each other's pictures as your banner on each of your individual profiles. So that's great. Good to hear. So in your work, you both talk about how leaders need to lead, and you use an acronym to talk about that has the word HEART at the center of it. Tell us what that stands for. Tell us first what the acronym is exactly and what each part of that acronym stands for and why it's so important.
Hardy is the word. We call it Hardy. And these are the six foundational skills that we believe leaders need to succeed in the 21st century, in the new world of work. And Hardy stands for, it's H-E-A-R-T, heart, I. And it's humility, empathy, accountability, resiliency, transparency, and inclusivity. And we believe that when you're able to master these six skills and identify where your strengths are when it comes to Hardy, that you are in a great position to take your organization to the next level. It starts with inclusivity, and inclusivity ties all of it together. One does not work without the other. If you're completely empathetic and none of the others, you won't be as successful as when you're able to weave humility with empathy, with accountability, resiliency, transparency, and inclusivity. So it's Hardy. We think it's the way that leaders need to move in the future and in the now. And we base a lot of our development programs, a lot of our consulting, and a lot of our research around Hardy. And Lisen can talk more because she's actually teaching it and at Stanford.
Yeah. So as Corey explained, what we started looking, you know, 2 or 3 years ago, what's the landscape of the new world of work? What's different in the 20th century versus 21st century? And what skills have evolved and need to evolve for leaders? Most leaders were trained to lead back in that kind of command and control hierarchy, et cetera, way of working, which made sense back in the day, but absolutely fails miserably today. And so we started actually interviewing and surveying and researching and conducting assessments, third-party research to understand what are those core competencies. And honestly, these six competencies kept bubbling up, kept telling us this is what made sense. So then we ended up kind of pulled Hardy together. We actually ended up surveying more to find out, to really prove our theory. And meanwhile, I was teaching this at Stanford in the executive leadership program and just being told, you've nailed it. This is exactly what we need. And so when leaders get trained on these skills and they understand where they're strong and maybe where they aren't strong and where they can grow, and also where their teams can complement each other. You might have one person with high empathy and somebody else with high accountability, and naming it and owning it is really important. So we're really thrilled with Hardy.
Fantastic. Hey, you know, I have a follow-up question to this. And this is a question that comes from my own personal experience and research, which is that I find that most good leadership qualities that people display come as a result of a combination of learned behavior that sits on top of a personal quality that they either have or they don't have. And what I mean by that is that if someone asked me, can someone learn a particular skill, let's say, for example, that makes them a more effective communicator when talking to their team members, I would say, yes, they can. Almost anyone can learn this new communication skill. But if they ask me, would they be motivated to use it on a regular basis? Would it become an internal part of their personality? There I would pause and say, it can, but it depends on certain aspects of their own nature. Is that true also in this particular case? And the reason why I ask in terms of being able to acquire the capability of being a Hardy leader is because there are people that I've encountered during my career and in my research that have achieved levels of leadership primarily because of their ability to perform a particular task, whether it be in marketing or in accounting or in sales or in some other area, but do not seem to be very fond of other people, to put it mildly. And when they
end call up those toxic rock stars, we literally have a name
toxic
for them.
Rock stars. Oh, that's great. Toxic rock stars. So when they're in a leadership position, they can know the right things to do, but have trouble with either bringing up the motivation to execute or executing in a way that comes across authentic and conveys well to other people. Is that the case here also? Is it a question of, yes, you have to have these qualities which you can acquire, but also there has to be some selectivity on the part of organizations in terms of who they give that precious privilege and responsibility for the care and nurturing of other people?
Joe, you're asking such important questions, and I want to kind of decouple them a little bit. The first question I heard you ask was, look, can we, you know, is nature, you know, is biology destiny, for lack of a better way of saying, you know, is our temperament defined, et cetera. And we are absolutely passionate about the work by Carol Dweck at Stanford about growth mindset. We fundamentally believe that, and we know, because the research all proves that you can actually change your point of view, change your behavior, et cetera. You've seen all this, you know, all of that. And in fact, what we think is a bit of a tragedy, and I'm sure our ERG partners can attest to, companies have not been investing in training for decades now. And so they're just putting these people who are really good at delivering on sales or really good at delivering in their engineering, product innovation, or whatever it might be, but have absolutely no management or leadership skills. And so they keep getting promoted up, and all of a sudden they're a big star in terms of delivering on revenue, you know, product innovation, but they're so toxic for the culture that they're actually ruining the culture. We just completed some fascinating research with the Billie Jean King Foundation and information around women of color in the workplace. The thing that came up again and again and again was why companies continue to support the toxic rock stars and what that does to company culture and how that and why that is part of the driver of the great resignation. I refuse to continue to work with that, pardon my language, person. And so I'm out of here, right? I mean, Corey, we saw this, we heard this in our research. Do you want to add to that at all?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, the thing about Hardy as well is we all know the definitions of those traits, right? Humility, empathy, accountability. They're readily understandable by most. And so we have a baseline knowledge of what that means. Where the challenge comes in a lot of times is inclusivity. And what we're talking about, the 21st century leadership that we're talking about, we know that diversity and inclusion are table stakes. Those are issues and challenges from the 18th, 19th centuries, let alone the 20th. So in order to be a true leader, we have to be able to move past that. And these toxic rock stars, whether they're hearing or not, or understanding or not, they are hearing that the requests upon them are changing, that they're shifting, that you have to be able to not just endear yourself to people, but connect with others. And these leadership skills, Hardy, is all about how you connect with others. It requires you to be connected to others in order to raise your group up, to raise your organization up. And so if you deny that, if you don't have an empathetic ear to that, then you're going to fail, and you're going to continue to see attrition like the Great Resignation, or you're going to have mutiny on your hands as a leader.
Yeah, absolutely. So shifting gears just a little bit, in your work, you also mentioned how you found five biases that get in the way of leaders succeeding. Can you share a bit about that?
Yeah, sure. So it's really, look, unconscious bias is real. That is biology, right? 11 million bits of information come to our brain that our brain processes unconsciously every second. But our conscious brain is only capable of processing around 40 to 50. That's fact. We know that, right? So of course, there's going to be how we interpret that data, how we interpret the inputs that we do. That's where the bias comes in. So there's all this kind of unconscious bias training, et cetera. And as you probably well know, and I'm sure your partners here can attest, it typically fails miserably, right? So we were trying to understand with our clients, what biases are really affecting the return to office and impeding culture moving forward? And so we started surveying and analyzing and working with clients. And here are the five biases that filtered to the top. And I'm just going to read them out. The first is anchoring bias. That's the idea that we have an anchor belief system and then new information comes in, but we're so attached to our anchor belief system that we're not willing to consider the new inputs. What's an anchoring bias right now? The anchoring bias right now is we all have to work in an office. Well, obviously the pandemic has told us we can be distributed and still be productive. So that's an example of anchoring bias. The next thing is confirmation bias. That is only listening to the information and the data that reinforces our belief systems. A perfect example of this, and Jamie Dimon does this so well, or so badly as the case may be, head of JP Morgan, he says, well, all the young people are dying to get back into the office. They have to get back into the office. They're eager. What he's denying the fact is that so many parents, so many people who have really long commutes, so many people who maybe have illnesses, they don't want to be in the office. But not listening to that data and that truth and listening only to that which confirms our beliefs is a problem. Affinity bias. Now, most people already know about affinity bias. It's that in-group and out-group mindset. It's that belief and that necessity when we were out on the savannah that help us understand what was an other and a risk and what was an in-group and was safe. That we bring all the time. And so much of our unconscious bias training is around affinity bias, right? But look, right now we've got affinity bias around, oh, for those of us who have, for one of our clients is a biotech company, and they've got people in labs who've been in labs the whole time, and they've got people work in the kind of remote working. And there's a challenge right now as they're getting people back into the office because the people in the labs have a team and everyone outside of the labs are othered, right? So how do you break through that and be inclusive to the people coming back to the office? Another bias, this is a big one, is productivity bias. So productivity bias is the, and this is shocking that research really validates that in fact, we believe that people who are sitting near us, literally physically sitting near us, and we can see that they're more predictable. I mean, they're more reliable, they're more productive, they're better workers. Even if in fact they're sitting there searching LinkedIn for new jobs or buying shoes on Zappos, it doesn't matter what they're actually doing. We impose our belief that they're productive because we literally see them. If you can't see someone because they're working from home, our productivity bias makes us think they're not being productive. There's a flip side to that. It's called presenteeism, where employees themselves will know that their managers have productivity bias and they're forced themselves to be in the office. Of course, in COVID, this isn't relevant necessarily, but when we come back to the office, are we going to see employees who are burnt out, exhausted, maybe ill, forcing themselves in because their leaders are so attached to productivity bias? So those are kind of five that we see again and again and again that we caution leaders and managers to be thinking through as they're evaluating their cultures in a return to office or a continued distributed environment. What does that mean? So yeah. Especially right now, so many companies are going through kind of performance reviews right now. And we're hearing this again and again. Well, oh, you know, I don't know if Corey was really that good because I didn't see, you know, how much he delivered. Of course, we've looked at productivity. It's been off the charts. So it's going to be an interesting review period at the very least.
Yeah. You know, as you were talking about that, I was thinking about some work I'm doing on my book right now. One of the things that I talk about is that we are entering a period where we're moving away from the workplace that once predominated only in one dimension, which was same time, same place, where people were all in this office. And that was in excess of 80% of the people were working that way pre-COVID. And then post-COVID, where 35% of the workforce became remote. And then post-vaccine, only a few of those people returned because 24% remained remote. And then you've also got people that are pouring into other dimensions of work, which are they're in the same place, but not at the same time. So shift work is increasing because of building restrictions in terms of how many people. And you've got a growing number of people that are working in different places and at different times also, which are again bleeding away more people from same place, same time. So as we enter this world where the workforce is more distributed, some of those biases that you talked about earlier can become a larger and larger problem for leaders that are trying to manage this four-dimensional workplace full of members of their workforce. And one of those workplaces or one of those dimensions is same time, same place, which is shrinking. And if that's all they're paying attention to, then they're only leading or effectively managing and connecting with a shrinking number of people as opposed to this larger group. So that certainly will not work going forward. Corey, you probably had some thoughts on this as well in terms of where all of this is heading and where we are right now relative to these different biases and how they impact the workforce.
Sure, absolutely. And just to piggyback on what you were just saying, I think leaders in general have to be, it's a call for them to be more culturally fluent, right? Because as we break away and become more distributed, you know, when you're in person in proximity, it's a little easier to drive the culture and, you know, kind of make it a top down, this is how we operate and this is what we do. Whereas when it's more distributed, you're crossing, you know, someone in a different state may think or operate differently than someone else or in a different country even. So you have to be more culturally fluent to understand how to connect with them, how to make sure that there's still rapport built virtually, so that when you do get in proximity again, when we are all able to meet again, that connection, that culture is still thriving, and you're able to be, and so, which means you have to align to purpose. Your purpose has to be extremely driving for your employees. Your values can't just be slapped on the wall. They have to really be embedded in everything that you do, the way you make decisions, the way you communicate, the way you create workspaces for your people. We have a workplace prism that look at companies and consult with them, that we identify here are the ways where your company is either excelling or where you need some work. And it's leaders, of course, culture, and then environment. What's their workspace like? Social, how are they viewed, right? So it's not just what you say about yourself. It's, are you being perceived that way outside of the organization? And then also governance. What are the policies, programs, and procedures that drive your culture, that help to attract people, to onboard them, and to how do we develop them? There has to be a focus on how we develop our people in order to keep them intrigued and involved and engaged.
And I would, just to build off of that, what we're hearing again and again is this deep importance of ERGs. Now more than ever, ERGs are helping solve the problems, Joe, that you were just talking about, right? And so the responsibility of the ERG leaders to be the translator, and the ERG teams to be the translator between what the employee experiences and what the leaders need to hear, it's never been more important. And we see this when we do our workplace prism assessments with companies. It's amazing how ERGs are now at the top of the list of, we've got to solve this. We've got to figure this out. We need to listen. So, you know, it's the power of ERGs have never been greater, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. I know we talked about this a little bit in our pre-discussion, and also in interviews that I've done with other people for the program. In fact, one of the CEOs that I had on the program, CEO of a large healthcare system, basically said, you know what, without listening to those voices, a leader is flying blind for all practical purposes. And so a lot of these organizations, the ones that are really savvy, are realizing that the ERGs actually represent the voices of various communities that make up their workforce. And that these communities collectively, if you listen to them, you realize different things like, yes, there are some people that want to go back for a variety of reasons, but there are also a group of people that find that that would be a tremendous inconvenience to them, and that they're not set up to support some of the things that they have, the responsibilities they have with their families that have shifted as a result of the pandemic, and that the company doesn't have an infrastructure to support them either and to enable them to be effective going back and forth to an office. They would know these things if they just listened. So I'm glad you went there, because that's exactly where I want to go now. Let's segue over to the ERG leaders. What are some of the stories that you've heard about CEOs that now are convening groups of ERG leaders to listen to them, to get a feel for what the organization wants, and other ERG groups that are actually becoming what I consider, and I'm talking about also in my book, they've become pollsters of the opinions and the thoughts and perspectives of their groups, which then they supply back to the organization so that the organization can make decisions that are grounded in a better understanding of the needs and the wants of this new workforce. What are some things that you're hearing on your end?
I'll tell you with a client we're dealing with right now. It's a fast growing tech client. They're kind of, you know, it's they're as one senior leader said, we're drinking through the fire hose, you know, we're like trying to move this business forward. And they reached out and said, we want to create an ERG. And our answer back to them was, why? What are you trying to do? What do you really want to accomplish? And it really felt, frankly, that they were just box checking. And our answer is, if you're just going to throw out an ERG and make it box check, you're wasting this gold mine that you have or could have if you structured it properly. If you set it up so that you actually had deep engagement from senior executives, if you create an environment where there's transparency and honesty and open communication, if you actually empowered the ERG leaders with funding, with support, with, you know, time, you know, the whole idea, one ERG leader we spoke to said, I've got a full-time job and then they want me to do this on top of it. That's just not right. I'm exhausted. And if you're, for example, a quarry out in the world, a man of color, you've got a full-time job and now they want you to be the translator of what every Black person in the entire organization looks like. Well, you know, that's no fun, is it, Corey?
No, right? It's not. Not at all.
It's not fair.
Yeah, it's not. And, you know, the other thing about these ERGs, Joe, is that this leaders really, they should be thanking their lucky stars that there are still people at their company willing to commit to driving diversity, being a vocal voice. Because as we've all talked about in this great resignation, there's a lot of attrition being happening. However, I've just read an article on Business Insider that talked about how disproportionately, of course, underrepresented groups are represented in this great resignation. And a lot of people, a lot of minorities are feeling that they don't have the resources or the abilities to participate in the great resignation, right? So they are staying around. And these leaders, these company leaders should truly value, especially with the great resignation, along with this call for more diversity from everyone, not just their employees, but from their customers, from investors. This is so important that they should value the people that are willing to stand up and say, hey, we want to help you get this right. We want you to understand the impact that your decisions make. We want you to continue to have an empathetic ear. And finally, I think it's coming through. Hey, now I am actually seeing with a different perspective what the ERG groups are saying to me. I'm understanding how I can be a more effective leader. And I'm having the humility to understand that I'm limited. So I'm just going to sit and listen. And so that is so powerful, Joe, that there's a group of men that are really interested in understanding how to get better and that they're relying upon their ERG leaders to help them guide them through this process.
Yeah, no, that's great. And, you know, one thing that occurred to me as you were both talking and, you know, Lisen brought this up first, which is that people who are ERG leaders have full-time jobs. And on top of that, they take on this responsibility. And yes, there's a value to getting the perspectives and opinions of other people in the group. But to do that, it takes work to collect that information and to summarize that information. I would think that one of the things that organizations would want to do is make that as frictionless as possible, make it as easy as possible so it does not take up much more time of that person who valiantly is stepping up and saying, I'll lead this. So give them tools, give them the mechanisms that they need to go out, collect the information, maybe put a template together. I know a couple of organizations I work with that put templates together. And when they ask the ERG leaders to do something, they make it so that it's so simple that it doesn't take that much of their time and they can produce a lot of value. They're wonderfully willing to do it, but we want to give them the tools so it doesn't overburden them much more than they're already being overburdened. And Corey, before I let you go, one more thing on this that I think from your perspective you can talk about as well is that just as the workforce is becoming more diverse, so is the marketplace. And the voices of these ERG leaders, especially when they are echoes of what a particular community thinks and feels, what attracts them, what resonates with them, are also important to organizations. one of the organizations that I do business with in terms of being able to put out good, solid public safety announcements relative to healthcare, basically got a lot of the input on how do you position this for certain communities from the ERG groups. And I'm sure, and you could do that in the for-profit and non-profit space as well. Any particular experiences that you've had in that area where ERGs have been able to also help the organization with that external audience that is similar to the community represented by one of these ERGs?
Absolutely. Working in the agency world, we would partner, we would encourage companies to basically review our work from a cultural standpoint. A lot of times, a lot of creative advertisers can have really wild ideas. And while they might attract attention and get a lot of attention, is it the right attention? And so especially we don't want the wrong attention when it comes to misrepresenting underrepresented groups, minority groups. And so we would always encourage them to say, hey, let's talk to your ERG groups as a resource, especially if content was targeted towards an audience in that group, say, hey, how is this received? Not only is it, how is it received, but does this stand up to the caliber of your purpose, of the things, of the values that you would like to see your company extol when they're talking to this group? Because what happens is, even if you're not a member of the ERG, if you're the only Black person in that company and an ad goes on television and your family or a cousin or a friend might say, what is up with that spot that I just saw? Why are they, you know, showing Black people in this light? Or why are they showing people this way? Aren't you a part of that? So it makes you cringe to say, oh yes, I am a part of this. Why didn't they reach out to us? We could have told them that this is not a good idea. And it just also goes to, and just again, speaking to the lack of diversity in a lot of these advertising creative spaces, the people that are these taste makers that are not diverse at all. They're only throwing stuff against the wall to say, oh, this is going to be great, and a great attention getting message. But again, it's the wrong message, and it's one that alienates their people. So by all means, any messaging, especially when it's tailored to a particular audience, lean into tapping into that ERG and getting their perspective and input.
Yeah, great point. As you were saying that, I was thinking about the company that put the car advertisement in South America about the Nova, which means doesn't go in Spanish.
That's right.
That's the car everybody there wants, the Nova, you know, the one that doesn't go. But in any event, what are some specific ways that ERG leaders can help their businesses to develop party? Is that something that they can get involved with as well, in addition to being that place that collects information and helps the organization to understand different constituencies or different communities? Lisen, I saw you nodding. Would you like to jump on that?
Well, I mean, I think I mentioned so much money is not being spent on learning and development, right? We want more, but there isn't. And what opportunities then does the ERG have? Well, what they can start doing, and to add to the long list of things that they're already doing, is to really actually be that learning and development visionary. What does my team need? What does my community, what does my ERG community need? And what does the company need to hear from us, right? And so actually mapping out a series of panels or communications or lessons around with Hardy as a framework. Okay, this month we're talking about empathy. Next month we're talking about accountability. What does that look like? How do you be accountable and deal with business imperatives if in fact, you know, you want to be inclusive too? And actually having those conversations. We did a whole thing in partnership with Fishbowl, whom you may know. Fishbowl is an online platform that people can go, it's kind of like LinkedIn with Twitter combined, if you will. It's really great. And we did a series of talks that were actually driven by their ERG requests saying, let's talk each week about what it is. What's humility look like? And we interviewed leaders. And then what's empathy look like? And we interviewed leaders. And we did that over a 6-week period. We had thousands of people attending those 6-week panel, you know, series of panels and interviews, because people were craving this content. So in terms of content delivery, that's a great way to infuse it and to create some attraction and drive and get people, if a goal is to get people outside of your ERG to attend and participate and make and help include them, having content that would inspire them to attend could be great.
I think the other area to focus in on for companies is hiring and onboarding, right? Yes. We're in the midst of the Great Resignation, but hopefully there will be people willing to come back to your organizations, and you've got to be able to help people or to improve your hiring process. How, when people are interviewing, especially if there are multiple rounds of interviewing, will they see anyone? Will they meet anyone who is racially diverse, or someone from the LGBTQ community in your company, or someone who might be disabled? How do you make sure that those people are being represented and seen along the hiring process, so that as you're interviewing diverse candidates, they see themselves? And then also, how do you include them, your ERG's input, not that they have to participate in every onboarding activity, but how do you include their input on onboarding? Where people are understood to say, oh, they get me. There are other people here that work like that are like me, because when I had this first meeting, this is how I was treated. When I got my manual or my digital workbook, this has me in mind. I see people that look like me that work here. They're able to allow me to ask wonderful questions. So how do you engage people in the onboarding process so that you can cut down on the attrition rates and the continued resignations?
It just blows my mind when I hear this. Oh, we've got a pipeline problem. I can't find them. Anybody in ERG, you know, you want to find someone, you know, you go talk to your ERG group, and they in their network have such a vast number of contacts. They can call in. They're a great recruiting tool. The fact that companies aren't using, you know, their ERGs as a resource there to me is just shocking.
Yeah. No, I totally agree. And by the way, one of the things I want to emphasize here is when you were talking, Lisen, before about doing workshops or panels or discussions around each segment of Hardy. Mm-hmm. I mean, if someone is looking for a way of setting up, let's say, 6 events for the next year as part of what they're doing for their ERG, there you've got a format, right? And exactly. You can do it from different perspectives also, because clearly what some of these things mean and how they interact with the lives of different communities within the organization is probably going to be a little bit different in terms of what the needs are and how they might show up. So you can have a variety of different discussions around this topic, and you can have them over the course of the year, and they can be pretty educational. And there you have an acronym that just follows its way through. So I love all of this. And one of the things I wanted to ask you both is, how can our listeners contact both of you for more information? What are some ways that they can reach out to you directly, as well as where can they go to learn more about Hardy, about the 5 biases, and all of these different things that we were talking about today?
So first, for Hardy, we'll just reiterate, you can get your own personal score and evaluation of where you sit in Hardy, quality is the strongest and where are you most vulnerable. If you go to hardyquotient.com for you and your leaders, you could, this is a great conversation starter for you and your team. When you figure out where your strength is, and you can align with others who have that same strength, also their vulnerability. So that's a great way to start and have at least a baseline understanding of Hardy and how you relate to it. And then you can reach us at prisonwork.com, on Instagram at 21prisonworkc, and on LinkedIn at Prison Work.
And then also feel free to reach out to us individually, Corey, C-O-R-E-Y, at Prism Work, PrismWork.com, or Lisen, L-I-S-E-N, at Prism Work. We're here to support you. We know that ERG leaders are under so much pressure right now, and we're here to support you in any way we can. So please do not hesitate to reach out. Find us on LinkedIn.
Perfect. Perfect. So let me just repeat one thing real quick, because I want to make sure that that gets clearly to our listeners who will be listening to the program later on. The website for the self-assessment is hardyquotient.com. Of course, that's https://www.hardy, H-E-A-R-T-I, quotient, quotient.com. And so thank you so much, Lisen and Corey, for joining us today. I really appreciated this. And I think that our listeners are going to really enjoy a lot of the information you shared today.
It was a pleasure. Thank you, Joe. Really love being here.